Hello and welcome to the Actual Tech Media Experts Series. My name is Scott Becker. I'm from Actual Tech Media, and I'm excited to be your moderator for this special event on top security threats. There's more out there than ransomware. So why single out and exclude ransomware? It's definitely the most, you know, top of mind security threat out there, and we justifiably focus on ransomware all the time, but it tends to take up all the oxygen in the room when it comes to security. There are other threats, and every once in a while, we think it's good to step back and make sure we're protecting against all of those. So that's what this session is about. Now, before we get to today's rundown of other important security threats and other ways to think about security, we do have a few housekeeping items that will help you get the most out of this session. First off, we want this to be an informative event for you, so we encourage any questions in the questions box in our webinar control panel. So not only will we have team members responding to questions during the live event, but we'll also have a dedicated Q&A portion at the end of the presentation where we'll discuss in greater detail some of the top questions that come in. That Q&A panel is also the place to just say hello, which a lot of you have been doing already. We love to hear where you're logging in from. And it's also the place to let us know if we can help in the unlikely event that you have any technical issues. So on that point, a browser refresh will fix most issues, but if that doesn't work, just let us know there in the Q&A and we will provide further technical assistance. Now, at the end of this webinar event, we will be awarding a $250 Amazon gift card to one lucky registrant. Of course, you must be in attendance during the live event to qualify for the prize, and the official terms and conditions of today's prize drawing can be found in the handout section. Just scroll to the bottom and you'll find the prize terms and conditions link there. Now, these Expert Series events are special product-neutral looks at pressing technology problems presented by an expert in the field. But the support of our sponsors make it possible for us to bring you this content, so we want to give a special shout-out to some of those sponsors. Over the next few slides, I'm going to share some messages from our sponsors today, and they'll refer to links that you can find in your handout section of the console at any time during the presentation. As always, the handout section also has a few valuable Actual Tech Media links. There's a link to the Guerrilla Guide Book Club, where you can get access to Actual Tech Media's great printed resources on technology topics. There's also a link to the ATM Event Center, which has our calendar of upcoming events like this one. Now, before we get into the main presentation, a few words from our sponsors. We are supported by Rubrik. Rubrik is a cybersecurity company, and their mission is to secure the world's data. They pioneered zero trust data security to help organizations achieve business resilience against cyber attacks, malicious insiders, and operational disruptions. Rubrik Security Cloud, powered by machine learning, delivers data protection and cyber resilience in a single platform across enterprise, cloud, and SaaS applications. Their platform automates policy management of data and enforcement of data security through the entire data lifecycle. They help organizations uphold data integrity, deliver data availability, continuously monitor data risks and threats, and restore businesses with their data when infrastructure is attacked. You can find more at the link on your screen. That's www.rubrik.com/ransomware, which is also available in your handouts. Today's event is also sponsored by Census. To ensure security teams have visibility into the threat landscape, they need access to a comprehensive and highly contextualized data set for both proactive and reactive security analysis at scale. With Census, organizations can get the most accurate data available, enabling teams to take down threats as close to real time as possible with no deployment or configuration required. The Census platform is the leading internet intelligence platform for threat hunting and exposure management. You can learn more there at search.census.io, which, by the way, is a link directly to a tool where you can do those searches. There's also links to a tutorial about how to use that tool and just to the main page, which has all kinds of other information. But it's a really cool tool. I highly recommend checking that out. This event is also brought to you by Metallic. Data protection starts before your data is compromised, not at the point of recovery. With Metallic ThreatWise from Commvault, you get fully integrated cyber deception technology that's seamlessly paired with their award-winning Metallic Data Protection as a Service. Now businesses of every size can spot and contain ransomware attacks before data leakage, encryption, or exfiltration. ThreatWise patented deception technology engages and surfaces threats across production environments through intelligent threat sensors that mimic and behave like real resources and are indistinguishable to bad actors. ThreatWise decoys bait bad actors to interacting with fake assets, exposing their attempts. Defend your data, don't just recover it. Go to metallic.io/trial to get started today. And finally, this event is made possible by Lacework. Lacework modernizes security for the cloud era. It's a platform that focuses on risks that matter most by helping you understand your cloud and helping you find unknown threats. You can see up to a 100-to-1 reduction in alerts, 80% faster investigations, and a 90% reduction in manual efforts. Lacework is a single platform for continuous security and integrated experience across clouds that is fast and flexible to operationalize at scale. Find out about the Lacework difference through the link on your screen or in your handouts. So once again, take advantage of that handout section where you can find all the links that you've just seen. And with that, let's get to today's fantastic content. So it's my pleasure to introduce you to our guide to top security threats today. We're joined by Howard M. Cohen, who's worked for technology vendors and channel companies as an executive, as a consultant, and as an author. He's got one of the most comprehensive perspectives on IT of anyone I know, with much of that experience in the security space, which is why I'm very eager to hear what he has to say about the security threats that you should be concerned about, aside from ransomware. So Howard, welcome, my friend.
Hey, Scott, how you doing?
I'm great. How are you?
I'm good. I have a question for you.
Okay.
The title of today's expert series presentation is Top Security Threats. There's more out there than ransomware. Did you intend for that to rhyme?
I did not.
Okay. All right. Shall I take it from here? Okay.
Please do. Take it away.
Thanks. Hello, everybody, and thank you for joining us in today's expert series. As Scott pointed out, I'm Howard M. Cohen. I refer to myself as a senior resultant because in all my years in the technology industry, the one thing I learned over and over again is that it's all about results. Nothing else speaks, just results. So it's all about better business outcomes. In terms of there's more out there than ransomware, we're going to talk about the positioning of ransomware and how it relates to a lot of other different kinds of threats, all of which we need to be aware of. So first off, let me start with today's word. If you've ever attended any of my presentations, you know that I like to start with a word of the day. It's the writer in me. I can't help myself. Today's word, obviously, is money. Money. Why is it money when we're talking about security? It's kind of obvious. 95% of all breaches are financially motivated. I would say the other 5% are probably malicious mischief, people who just want to mess with your network for fun and games, which is terrible. But 95%, they're looking for money and they're looking to get it from you. In terms of the most common types of cybercrime, you'll notice that the first one is phishing, vishing, smishing, which is not a Three Stooges routine. It's really three different ways in which people can gain access to your network for the purpose of depositing ransomware there. There's also many other kinds of, there's personal data breaches, there's extortion. You know, I mean, you think about it, even ransomware is extortion. There's many different kinds of extortion. My favorite on this list, my least favorite really, is tech support. I have several elderly neighbors who have come to me at one time or another and said that they got this big message on their computer that said they've been hit with a virus. And, oh, my God, it's going to eat all their data. What do they do? What do they do? And I asked them what they've done so far. Many of them have told me they clicked the link there and they got a guy talking to them and they sent them $500 and That's the tech support exploit. They bilk people out of their money by telling them that they're in a threat. The real threat is the guy they're paying that money to. So there's all kinds of cyber crime going on around us. And I thought I would try and break that down in a way that we can think about it structurally. Two things I wanted to point out. Number one is there's been a substantial change. If I was giving this presentation several years ago, I would be telling you that it's amazing but true that 80% of all computer security compromises come from within your company. There are people doing malicious things that are inside your company. They are within your firewall. And today, that has flipped on its head. Today, 80% are from outside your company. Well, that means our protection strategies have to change. And change they have, but let's keep on going. What we're entering into, or actually what we've entered into long ago, is the age of social engineering. The age of social engineering. You could think about it as the interface between the computer world and the human world. But the fact of the matter is that if there are 2,200 incidents per day on average, greater than 90% of those use social engineering. They attack through people. So a lot of what we're going to talk about involves social engineering. All attacks, no matter how they're architected, consist of three basic stages. The first stage is how they get in. How do they get into your network? How do they make entry? How do they gain access to your data resources? Once they're in, what kind of damage do they do? How much damage? What's the nature of that damage? And then the question that I'm sure is on everybody's mind here, how much does it cost? What is the cost and what is the impact to my business when they do this damage? So we're going to kind of look at it that in that structure. Before we move on, I wanted to point out that ransomware fits right in the middle. Ransomware is an attack that does significant damage. It is not a way in. It is not an exploit that makes entry into. That's done for it through some of the means we've already talked about, phishing, vishing, smishing, etc. But it is a damage. It's a way to do damage. And very specifically, as I think you already know, they basically corrupt your data, encrypt your data, or outright steal your data, and then make you pay a ransom if you want to get your data back. So now we've positioned the ransomware threat. Let's see all the other threats that exist around it. How do they get in? There are really three primary ways we see them getting in. The first one is stolen credentials. They get somebody's password and they use it to make entry into the network. This is unbelievably easy to do. Many people still write their password on a sticky note and stick it to the front of their monitor. The clever ones stick it to the bottom of their keyboard. No matter how they do it, it's foolish. It's not something you want your people doing ever. It's just one way in which credentials can be stolen. The next one is phishing. And the last one is exploitation of vulnerabilities, either those caused by Trojans, viruses, and worms, or by those that are caused by mistakes, inadequate architecture of your security schema. People find ways in. So these are the three general ways into the network. Which is the largest vulnerability that enables people to breach your network? What do you think it is? What do you think is the greatest vulnerability that enables more breaches than anything else? I hope by now you've guessed that it's people. In fact, 3/4 of all exploits basically focus on people. They enter through people. People have to do something. Now, that something could simply be a mistake. They make an error. They hit the wrong thing. They leave something switched off. They, very simply, they leave the door to their office open and their computer logged in. I mean, that is as simple an error as there can be. And then somebody walks in the middle of the night, uses their computer. They could misuse privileges. There, you know, people don't have access to everything in their company. Somebody may want to see what everybody gets paid. So they may use privileges that they got inadvertently and take a look at payroll. Things like that happen all the time. So privilege misuse is another way in which people can cause breaches. We mentioned stolen credentials and social engineering. So there are many ways in which people can be fooled into letting us in or simply let us in by their own actions. So I want to talk about stolen credentials because we keep bringing it up. 86% of these exploits involve some way, shape, or form stolen credentials, making it the most popular entry point for breaches. This is how most people get into most networks to commit ransomware or other kinds of fraud all the time. Irresponsible users. I mentioned the sticky notes that you see there on the monitor. That's just one way in which people can be irresponsible. People can put all of their passwords into an easily accessed contact database. People use the word password as their password. They use 123456789 or 987654321 as their password. Easily guessed passwords are responsible for a big proportion of breaches. Weak passwords is just one way of being irresponsible. You'll notice that many networks are now requiring you to construct your password with a capital letter, a lowercase letter, a number, and a special symbol. That can make for very strong passwords. And as far as I'm concerned, if you're not using multi-factor authentication today, you're committing a crime against your company. Multi-factor authentication means that to get into the network, you have to combine something you know, your password, with something you have, your mobile device, on which you get that 6-digit number that you enter in when asked to. There's been talk about Microsoft obsoleting passwords. You know, that's great. It becomes possible when you're using multi-factor authentication. And I recommend that anybody who's operating any kind of network, large or small, it's easy to enable multi-factor authentication these days. It's a must-have, not a should-have. Phishing. We've talked about phishing several times. 44% of all social engineering incidents involve phishing. That's a major proportion. The most popular way to phish is called a business email compromise, or a BEC. You'll see that in the press a lot now. How does that work? The user receives a genuine looking email. So they're sitting there, an email pops into their inbox from the bank, and they open it up and they see the name of their bank using the logo of their bank. And the entire email uses the coloration that the bank's brand uses, the same typography that the bank uses. Everything about that email looks as if it came from the bank. And it didn't. It did not come from the bank at all. If you take a look at the URL for that site that you've arrived at, you'll see it's not composed of all letters. The O's may be zeros. The L's may be ones. there's many other ways in which they fool the user, but the user is fooled. There are malicious links in these emails. So it asks you to click here to get the information you've been looking for, or click here to finish filling out some form, or click here. If you click there, you open up the door, and the bad actor can then come through it and start creating havoc. And once they're inside your network, they can move laterally around your network to other network segments, to other networks that you're involved with. So you don't want to let them in. You've got to become very adept. And when I say you, I mean all of your users, all of your users, because it only takes one to let somebody in. All of your users must be diligent about identifying these malicious links on these phishing emails. The other thing that they do sometimes is to put attachments on these emails. And it becomes very attractive to open that attachment. It may be an offer for a special deal or something like that. Don't open that attachment, because once again, it'll open the doors, bad actor comes through, and now you're in a world of hurt. A new one that I just encountered the other day is what I refer to as blurry forms. They ask you to fill out a form, and on the email or on the screen, there is an image of a form you need to fill out. It's not readable. It's too small to be readable. So you figure, okay, so let me see what this is. You click on the blurry form, and instead of a big version of it opening up, your network opens up and the bad actor comes through once again. So there are more and more ways in which people are penetrating networks by fooling your users. More recently, we've seen a rise of pretexting. What is pretexting? Well, we mentioned smishing and vishing before. Here they are. This is where we get them. Smishing is the same as phishing, except it's on your text messages instead of your emails. Now, you may think, well, that's no big deal, but it is. See, surveys have shown us that 22% of all emails get opened, but 98% of all texts get opened. Which one's more dangerous? And SMS is overtaking email as a way to keep in touch with each other. Vishing is voice. They manage to exploit you through a voice call. And I've just found out about that recently. I'm going to be doing more study, and I'll hopefully come back and talk all about vishing at some point, unless it doesn't catch on, which we hope happens. And then there's exploitation of vulnerabilities. The most popular one being malware, trojans, viruses, worms. Web applications can have exploits embedded in them, and you can trip into them just by accessing that web application. It's never a good idea to use a web application that you're not thoroughly familiar with, that just kind of came to you and made itself available. You want to prove out that it comes from a reliable source, because that's another vector in which they can get in. Any cloud data should be suspect. You know, between the cloud and you, there are plenty of ways that bad actors can impact, corrupt, and exploit your data. Supply chain attacks. We talked about this a moment ago. When somebody enters, let's say somebody enters the network of one of your suppliers, and they put ransomware there, and they're demanding that they pay a ransom to get their data back. And then all of a sudden, you have ransomware on your network. What's happened is a supply chain attack. They've moved laterally from your associate, from your supplier, to you. And they'll probably move on from you to your customers. They can move in every direction. They can move all along the supply chain. if they're sufficiently sophisticated. So that's a kind of attack that we see on the rise. We have always been worried about zero-day vulnerabilities. Today, no less than ever before. Each and every day, new viruses are being introduced into the wild. New Trojans, new worms, new exploits of all kinds. And on that first day when they're introduced, no antivirus software provider has a signature to protect against them. They, you know, you download signatures from your antivirus provider daily. But if they haven't seen it yet, they can't have created a signature to protect against it yet. So on that first day, you're very vulnerable to that brand new exploit. Of course, if these are bad rumors, but if an antivirus company introduced a vulnerability, their problem is they would know how to protect against it. That's the only way. There is really no other way unless there's espionage involved. And that doesn't happen. So zero-day vulnerabilities are very, very dangerous. Desktop sharing software. Many of us use desktop sharing software, especially in the days of collaboration platforms. You want to edit documents together to make the whole editing process go faster. Sometimes you may need to access from inside the firewall, from inside the data center, and you can do so by accessing a computer that's in there using remote desktop protocol. If somebody gets your credentials, they can use the same desktop, remote desktop protocol software to get into your network, even though they don't belong there. So remote desktop sharing software, very dangerous. Misconfigured or unpatched firewalls. Patches come out regularly, and they are meant to be applied. If you don't apply them, you become the most desirable target for bad actors. They go looking for unpatched firewalls, and those are the ones they'll attack because it's easier. It's a whole lot easier. You've got to be diligent about patch application and patch management. And you've got to be diligent that when you apply them properly and configure them properly. That's one really good way for knowledgeable bad actors to get in. It's also a good reason to keep your software updated. Eventually, all software reaches an end of support life. There'll be no more patches. And those, oh boy, bad actors go hunting for those. I used to write a migration expert zone column, and we talked, it was in the days of Windows 2003 and Windows Server 2003. And after 10, 12 years, they were finally coming end of life. Way extended for all kinds of bad reasons, but everybody was still using them. And they announced the dates that they were going to go full end of life, no more patches. And every cyber criminal tuned themselves up on detecting those platforms, Windows 2003 and Windows Server 2003. And they caused untold damage. Keep your software updated. When a new version comes out, upgrade. Not only because you want the new features and benefits, but because you also want the new patches that will come out and continue to protect you. And finally, net it all out, irresponsible cyber hygiene. Cyber hygiene means taking good care of your network, your own user sessions, and your own user devices. Make sure that your personal protection software is always up to date. Make sure that you change your passwords regularly and that you use strong passwords. There's all manner of ways in which you can be a better protected cyber citizen. And practicing excellent cyber hygiene is the way to do that. Now, the damage they do. When they get into your network, what do they do when they get there? So let's look at the damage done. The most obvious one is ransomware. They introduce software that will corrupt or encrypt your data. You can't get at it anymore because they haven't given you the key. That key will cost you. Used to cost millions of dollars every time. And then cyber criminals realize that the smaller companies, they should charge a small ransom because they stand a better chance of getting paid. And so you'll see very small ransoms being demanded sometimes. That makes ransomware more dangerous because it encourages them. So take good care about ransomware. Other crimes are being committed against companies and their users once they're inside. Theft of identity is very popular. Theft of financial information. Flat out theft of money, credit cards, data assets. You know, there's so many things that they can simply steal from your servers once they're inside your network. And that damage is unbelievable. It all usually results in fraud. Somebody commits fraud against somebody, like when they steal a credit card. They commit the fraud of using someone else's credit card to buy goods and services. That's fraud. Theft of identity leads to fraud. They do business with somebody pretending they're somebody else. They get the goods and services, but they never pay because the billing goes to the original user. There are many other frauds that are committed, but you can consider any of that fraud damage done by a bad actor penetrating your network. There are still denial of service attacks. You know, if you go on a survey of, you know, of security reviews, used to be that you would find denial of service, DOS, or distributed denial of service, DDoS, attacks being prevalent. Not so much today. They're still out there, though. In a denial of service attack, the cyber criminal basically makes it impossible for your network to operate. You can't receive requests and you can't return results. In a distributed denial of service, the bad actor enlists thousands of computers, thousands of hosts, and has all of them make requests of your servers simultaneously. The sheer volume shuts down your servers, shuts down your network. So those are still out there. They're still happening. And we need to be very vigilant to make sure that we're protecting ourselves against them. Then there's, of course, the Internet of Things. The Internet of Things is not a separate internet. It is our internet, the internet we all know and love. It's just that instead of people connecting through computers on it, they're simply connecting things directly to the network, to the internet. According to Cisco, there have been more things on the internet than people since 2008. That's 15 years that there are more things than there are of us on the internet. These things include sensors. They include switches and other kinds of controls. Obviously, they perform important functions. If somebody were to take over an Internet of Things system, they could conceivably receive the data from all those sensors. They could conceivably mischievously operate those controls. You can imagine a million different ways in which that can cause unbelievable damage. Some of that damage involves what are called industrial control systems, ICS. ICS is the industrial strength version of smart home systems, really, when you come down to it. Industrial control systems control things like heat, power, and light in an industrial building, an office building, a factory, a manufacturing plant. They monitor each and every room with sensors. to determine what the temperature is in that room. And then they provide as much heating or cooling as that room needs if that room is occupied. If the room is not occupied, it doesn't spend a penny on it. Similarly, if the room is occupied, it switches the lights on. And when the room becomes unoccupied, it switches the lights off. It may seem like simple things to do, but this is saving billions of dollars for companies every year, simply by controlling the environment that everybody's working in. And that's great. It's great to save money. It's great to have these automated controls taking care of everything for you. Those of you who've put in smart home systems know how convenient it is to tell Alexa, hey, open that door or open my garage door, reset the thermostat, turn lights on, what have you. Here's the problem. If they have penetrated your network and they can take control of your industrial control system or even your home smart home system, let me give you an example that illustrates the extreme. I live in the Phoenix area, Phoenix, Arizona. And in the city of Phoenix itself, there are very tall office buildings. Imagine if somebody broke into the network for one of those tall office buildings and shut down the air conditioning in August or July. It's about 120 degrees in the shade here in July. Imagine how, you know, it won't take very long before that building becomes insufferable and you have to empty people out of it and get them back to some air conditioning somewhere. That means that everybody working in that building has stopped working. And business being conducted in that building has been completely disrupted. So that's one way in which an industrial control system can be leveraged to really cause havoc within a company. Similarly with a smart home. If you have smart locks, somebody gets into your network, they can instruct the network to open the lock and let me in. And they're in your house. If you're not there, they'll steal you blind. If you are there, it's even worse. So industrial control systems, smart home systems, all these automation systems can cause damage once a bad actor has entered your network. Physical damage. Imagine an industrial control system in a water treatment plant or a water distribution center. And the bad actor gets in and opens all the floodgates. Now water is coming out of every imaginable pipe and opening that it possibly can. The entire place is flooded. Water is cut off to hundreds of thousands of residents. That's physical damage. Imagine a smart city and the bad actor takes over control of traffic lights. Just think about the damage they could cause just by changing the traffic lights at the worst possible times, or turning them all red and freezing the city completely. There are many ways in which physical damage can be caused using digitally automated means. So physical damage can take place thanks to these bad actors. Reputational damage. We talked about those phishing emails. No matter what you do, anybody receiving a phishing email that looks like it comes from you will impact your reputation. They will associate you with that bad experience. And it's very difficult to get them to back off. Similarly, if bad actors send email using your domain, they can send all kinds of awful, prurient, damaging materials. And spam filters will catch that. And eventually, you will be unable to send an email to anybody without it getting sent to their spam filter. So reputational damage is no joking matter. It can cut you off from the world. We already talked about some ways in which business can be lost. We get all the people out of the business, out of the building, and nobody's working. But trust is a major component of any business agreement. If you compromise that trust, even externally, that can turn into a customer simply going elsewhere or deciding not to take a contract with you. So it's very easy for bad actors to basically reduce the volume of your business, to lower your bottom line. Business disruption, of course, we talked about people coming out of the building. But even more to the point, we're living also in the age of digital transformation. And basically, digital transformation happens when a company uses automation to execute processes that really don't require people to do them. Repetitive things, simple things, lots of them. Lots of them are integral to the operation of the business, but they are so simple that digital automation can handle them. Well, now with digital automation handling more of our business operations, bad actors can come in and stop them. They can stop the automation. They can grind your general operation to a halt. Everybody's sitting in front of blank screens because none of the processes are working. So it is easy to disrupt your business operations. And again, reduce your revenue line dramatically. And then, of course, there's regulatory compliance. Many businesses are impacted by government regulation. All businesses are impacted by software license regulations that they have to obey, the EULA, the End User License Agreement. And they're also subject to their own regulations. We spoke about how all of this begins with policy and governance. If you have a policy, people have to follow it. Well, it's very easy for a bad actor to create conditions that will cause lapses in that compliance. And those lapses will lead to fines. And you can scream, yell, and holler at the auditors that, hey, that's not my fault. They don't care. You're responsible for protecting yourself. And so you are liable for what have become enormous fines. So again, damage that these bad actors can do when they make their way into your network. This is not getting smaller. All of these things are happening. It, depending on which survey you look at, we are anywhere between $9 and $13 trillion in losses to cybercrime globally this year. That's up from less than $1 trillion in 2018, 5 years ago, and barely half of what we project it to become by 2027, 4 years from now. So the cybercrime problem, all the problems that relate to and that exist in conjunction with or apart from ransomware, it's all growing. It's all getting worse. And the more we get dependent upon digital support, the more they can attack. Finally, we get to the costs and the impacts. Cyber costs are up 80% year over year. And try and, you know, picture this. The average cost, if you took all breaches all around the world and divided by the number of breaches, the average would come out to $4.82 million per breach. Per breach. That's where that $10 or $11 trillion comes from. If that breach takes place in the United States of America, it's more like $9.44 million. So it's double here in the United States. What does that tell you? And again, depending on what survey you look at, this survey says we'll be at 10.5 trillion by 2025. The Statista survey said we're already going to be at 11.3. When you're talking about trillions of dollars, you're talking about trillions of dollars. And by the way, the simple business email compromise, if you're hit with one, the average cost of that to you is 50 grand. And that's not peanuts either. What are the most expensive breach vectors? How do they get you? Business email compromise, $4.89 million per compromise on average. Phishing exploits, $4.91 million. Malicious insiders, $4.18. Social engineering attacks, very popular, $4.1. And people attacking through software vulnerabilities, $4.55 million. It's very costly. And as we talked about a moment ago, the costliest types of cybercrimes are business email compromises, phishing, that all leads to ransomware. You will notice that ransomware isn't even on here, really. They talk about personal data breaches. They talk about other things like that, corporate data breaches, but they're talking more about the way in and what is done once they've come in. There are all kinds of investment scams that use data stolen from your networks. There's certainly personal data breaches, getting people's credit card information and other personal information so they can take over their accounts through identity theft. My favorite tech support exploit, let's go stamp that out. There's all kinds of fraud taking place, people impersonating the government. So none of these are inexpensive. None of these are cheap. And all of them require protection. So how do you protect yourself? Well, I guess you could hire Wonder Woman. That'd be do something. But these days, most people are using tools. They've got a tool for anti-phishing. They've got a tool for antivirus, another tool for anti-spam. There's all kinds of tools, one for each different kind of thing that happens. And of course, the problem with tools is that somebody's got to know how to use them. And if that somebody leaves, you're in trouble. Also, if you have 100 tools, that's 100 support agreements, 100 different trainings. It's a lot. And none of it works well with each other necessarily. You may find that something you're doing to protect against one thing could really help another, but it doesn't. These days, we look more for best of platform. We look for platforms that do as much of this as it possibly can. And we end up usually with one, if we're lucky, maybe two or three different platforms that cover the entire expanse. Now, that expanse looks something like this. Lots of different things you need to be able to do. Lots of different tools you need to be able to do them. If you can break these down into a few simple categories by getting a platform that does it, you've got coordinated activity. It's all built to work together. It's one set of training, one set of support resources, and all of your people working together in unison. So platform is just a better way to approach all this. And let's break this down. First and foremost, you want to be able to establish and enforce your security policies. Without a policy, there's nothing to enforce. So you're not enforcing anything. With policy, everybody has a foundation for a common understanding of what their responsibilities are in your environment. Again, I'll put multi-factor authentication at the top of any list of important functions. You need multi-factor authentication and a comprehensive identity and access management schema. Many different things you can do with IAM and MFA. And if you bring them together, that's a pretty powerful combination. Of course, you have a lot of remote users. And Remote users generally connect to your network using a device. When they do, you certainly want to authenticate the user, but you also want to evaluate and authenticate the device to make sure that the device is capable of being on your network. Endpoint detection and response. People are no longer satisfied hearing, okay, we found the problem, we're identifying it, figuring out what to do about it, and we'll get it fixed any day now. That's just not acceptable anymore. These days, it's got to be instantaneous, real time. EDR has to happen very quickly. And so new platforms attack it in a very different way and provide that rapid response that your users are demanding. SIEM, Security Incident and Event Management, also helps you avoid fines if you violate reporting requirements. Whenever you're hit with a breach, most companies have reporting requirements. They have to report to certain local, state, and federal agencies that they had a breach. If they don't, they can be fined. So SIEM helps you manage every incident, every event, and it also helps you make sure you're properly reporting on each. We talked about intrusion detection. I don't know about you, but I'd rather not be waiting to detect something. I'd rather be preventing something. And there are intrusion prevention systems that incorporate that detection and take it much further for you. Applications can easily be penetrated unless they're secured, properly hardened. Patches, they've got to be applied. They've got to be applied properly and in a timely fashion. Network penetration testing, we just talked about that with network access control. Network penetration testing, you have to prove that what you did works, that you are preventing bad actors from getting in. In the world of compliance, regulatory compliance, you have to not only implement a measure, you have to prove that that measure is working. Otherwise, you're going to fail audit, and it's going to cost you. Data loss prevention, obvious. Antivirus software, obvious. Email security, obvious. Security of your wireless devices. You don't want to leave a wireless device unprotected. People passing by outside your building can access through those. You want to segment your networks to insulate each segment from each other so that if a bad actor gets in, they can't as easily move laterally around the network to create other exploits. Web security, as we talked about before, and many of you are still using virtual private networks, you've got to be able to manage those as well. So this is a comprehensive, I think, list. I'm sure I've left some things out. But if you're going to protect against anything, there's one thing that you must make sure you use. One resource that will probably be the most effective security resource you have. And yep, that resource is people. Yes, 40 minutes ago, I called them your greatest threat. They are also your greatest asset. Work hard to be constantly reminding them, keeping them constantly aware of their responsibility regarding great cyber hygiene. Recognize that they can do something foolish at any given time and remind them of the implications. Scare them, train them, acculturate them. But whatever you do, create an active program that has them looking out for all of these threats. Because a person spotting one of them can be your best protection. Scott, have we received any questions?
We certainly have. Yeah, great presentation, Howard. Thank you. I got to say one thing too. You know, early on you talked about, 95% of threats these days being financially inspired, and I think, or motivated. And I think of, like, we've both been around the industry long enough that was flipped you know, it was like 95% were sort of that malicious mischief, you know, and now it's just really become huge business. Mm-hmm. And obviously that shift happened a while ago, but it's just interesting to think about.
It's because of inflation.
So questions we've got here. Dean, a couple of people have this similar questions. You know, Dean's asking, is the rise in AI contributing to vishing? And Matt is asking similarly, you know, what changes, you know, would you recommend as far as, you know, or things like ChatGPT, you know, making phishing more sophisticated?
Honestly, we are early in the development or the rollout of AI, and all of us are trying to look into the future and see what the consequences, implications will be. AI has the ability to spot exploits or potential exploits faster than humans can. I don't know any human who can adequately scan a security log. The volume of traffic data is monumental. Yet, a good AI system with great machine learning, no problem. It can parse the whole thing and give you immediate feedback. So it can be a great help in combating. And you bet you're going to see all the major security software providers implementing AI into their products over the next few years. And I think it'll happen pretty quickly. At the same time, bad actors can leverage AI to be amongst the best cyber criminals of all time, because they can do the same things cyber criminals do, but much faster and much more precisely. So from a, you know, from a 100,000 foot view, we may see AIs on both sides of that equation. Then, of course, it becomes interesting watching an AI attack a network and another AI combat that. There's a joke about Rock'em Sock'em Robots in here somewhere, but I'm not going to come up with it.
Yeah, but I think you're absolutely right about it being deployed on both sides. And there's sort of mixed opinions on which side would come up out on top on that. And the only way to find out is, you know, as it sort of plays out. So Matt and Dean, thank you for that question. That's a great question. Next one here, it comes from Chris, who's wondering if you distinguish the safety of cloud data, whether it's stored on public or private cloud. Like, do you think about it differently?
Okay, so whether it's on public or private, the fiduciary responsibility for the data remains with you. Look at any cloud provider's contract and you'll see it right in there. They take no responsibility for the actual payload. They don't really need to see your payload. They have no need to view your data in any way, shape, or form. In terms of protecting that data, I think if you look at one of the largest public cloud providers, Microsoft, or if you look at Google or Amazon Web Services, all of them have gone on best security campaigns, letting potential users know that they can trust the protection that is incorporated into their services. And that's great, because I don't think anybody could spend more money on it than they can. Certainly, your company or my company couldn't do that. So it's a safe bet with public cloud. With private cloud, many of them make the same claims, but I think there's more of an element of your participation in protecting the data and protecting access and so forth. Private cloud can appear functionally much as a local server does in the grand scheme of your architecture. So I don't know that there's a huge difference, but from a strategic standpoint, the one thing I know I can depend upon, it sounds funny, if we were sitting here 10, 12 years ago, it would be quite the opposite. But today, I trust security from Google, AWS, Microsoft, the big players, IBM, I trust them a lot more than I trust me to provide adequate certain security.
Yeah, great points. Well, Howard, I think we're going to have to leave it there. Great presentation. Thanks for your insights here in the Q&A. As always, it's, I love to hear from you on topics like this. So it's
same
it's
here, my friend.
Great having you.
Thank you all. Thank you all for your attention.
All right. And before we wrap up, we have one more piece of business. It's the Amazon gift card prize drawing. And the winner of that $250 Amazon gift card today is Rita Patel from Illinois. So congratulations to Rita. We'll be in touch to get you your card. And with that, on behalf of the Actual Tech Media team, I want to thank our sponsors for making this event possible. That's Rubrik, Census, Metallic, and Lacework. And thanks as always for attending and for your great questions. That concludes today's event. Have a fantastic rest of your day and a great weekend.